which I put up here, and because this is Windows, I can't figure out how to make the image larger. This is the old English text, okay? And a couple of times during the class, I'm going to make some comments about individual words in the translation, because they need to be discussed. One point to bear in mind, and I don't think I discussed this the other day, I'm going to turn the light back on, is every time you translate something from one language to your own language, you are interpreting. So every act of translation is an act of interpretation. All right? Bede essentially tells us that in that passage we read last week where he talks about Cadman's hymn, and he says, this is the sense, though not the exact. Why? Because Bede is writing Cadman's hymn into Latin. He's translating it from its Old English into Latin. The Old English versions that we have today are versions that are translated from Bede's Latin. Okay? So it was written in Old English, translated to Latin, translated back into Old English. Those are the versions that we have today. And we have multiple versions. Okay? To give you an idea of kind of translation history, let's say, in Shakespeare's day, and we'll talk about Shakespeare when we get up to it. In Shakespeare's day, when he went to the local grammar school, the King Edward VI school in Stratford, he probably, beginning around the age of 6 or 7, began learning Latin and Greek. Okay? He would have left that grammar school around the age of 11 or 12. He would have known probably more Latin and Greek by the time of 11 or 12 than a modern American classics major would know after graduating college with a degree in classical languages. Okay? One of the reasons for that is by the age of 8 or 9, Shakespeare's Latin teachers would have given him a text, say, Caesar's Gallic Wars, would have given him a passage of that in Latin that he would have to translate into English. Okay? They would then compare, that teacher would then compare the Latin text with the English translation to make sure the English translation is accurate. That's the first part of the translation exercise. The second part would then be for Shakespeare to take his English translation and translate it back into Latin without the benefit of the Latin text. Okay? And in the mid-1580s, the idea would be that the text translated from English into Latin should match the Latin original perfectly. In other words, the English translation has got to be so accurate that when it is translated back from that English into Latin, it should match. Okay? We don't necessarily do that anymore. We probably should. I should probably require my old English students to do that. The text we're talking about today, the Old English Elegy, The Wanderer, survives in one of what's called the four major poetic codices. There are four major manuscript books of Old English. You've got what's called the Vercelli manuscript, which is in Italy. You've got the Exeter manuscript, which is at Exeter Cathedral in Exeter, England. You've got the Junius manuscript, which is in Bodleian Library, London. And then you have what's called the Noel Codex, okay, which is in the British Library. This is the manuscript also sometimes called the Beowulf manuscript because it contains Beowulf. Okay? So you have these four major ones. There are a bunch of others. There are about 400 actual manuscripts that contain Old English. Some of them are literally scraps. Okay? Some of them are today unreadable because they burned. But they survive. That is, the British Library still has these things. They're essentially clumps of charcoal. and the British Library, in its wisdom, has kept them until technology is able to decipher them. And we're getting to that point. We've now been able to decipher some of the burned manuscripts. Okay? And I'll talk a little bit later about why they were burned and how they were burned and that kind of thing. So the Exeter manuscript is the one that contains The Wanderer and the Seafarer, the next poem. Yeah, The Wanderer and the Seafarer, okay? Dream of the Rood, which will be the poem after that, is in the Bocelli manuscript, okay? And then Beowulf is in this manuscript. To give you an idea of what the manuscript looks like, again, I can't make the image any larger because it's a retarded Windows machine. This is the Exeter manuscript. The Exeter is kind of a finished manuscript. That is, it appears it was written in very high quality script, okay, and it was designed to be presented. We know actually when this manuscript came into being and when it came to the Exeter Cathedral. Leverage, Bishop Leverage of Exeter, had this manuscript made, and it has been in the cathedral since 1015. Okay. You can still go there today and look at it if you have the appropriate credentials and such. Okay. But that at the top there, it reads, Oftim an haga ariyabinath mehtudas milza, etc. Notice how it looks on the page. It's not divided into lines, right? It looks like a paragraph of prose, okay? So let me go back to this one. And let's start looking at the poem. Now, the translation that you have in the Broadview Anthology is by Roy Liuza, who is an Anglo-Saxon scholar, originally Tulane, then he went to University of Tennessee, Knoxville. He was there for several years. Then he went up to University of Toronto, where he headed up the Dictionary of Old English for a few years, and he's back at University of Tennessee, Knoxville. He's probably one of the top, 10 to 20 Anglo-Saxonists in the world. So if, as English majors, you decide to study Old English, UTK would be a good place to go where you could study with one of the greatest Anglo-Saxonists alive. Having said that, I'm going to pick apart parts of his translation, okay? Again, every translation is what? It's an interpretation, okay? Because as you translate words, you are choosing individual words, and that means you're doing what to all the other possible words? You're pushing them away. Okay? And if your translation is not for yourself but for other people, what then are you doing for their reading and understanding of the poem? You are guiding them on an interpretation. Okay? Now, the very first word, which you can probably not make out from where you are, oft. Now, we have that same word in modern English. We throw in the N. But you can still use oft, okay? Does oft mean always? That's how Liuza translates it, very first word. Oft, always, okay? Often and oft doesn't always mean always. It can mean most of the time, nearly always, okay? But by saying always, okay, you're being directed in one way. So, the Old English, which I'm going to stop looking up there and look at the one I printed out here. The Old English reads for the first couple of lines. Actually, I'm going to do the first five lines. And here, let me write this on the board. Wait, unless you can read that, it might be easier to follow this way. Oft him on Haga. All right. Yeah, it's a G. Sorry. All right, Yabinath. Mint tutus. Say, we saw that word last week with Cadman's hymn. Mint tutus mocta. It's just spelled a little bit differently. Tha, a, he, mode, carry, yon, lagu, lade, longa, shelde, fern, mid, hondu. Rim, calder, trying to write in Ash. My hand is not following my brain. Sad, laden, reclustus, weird, bith, fool, orat. Notice what I have not included there. Punctuation. Okay? I've not included any punctuation. If I were to pull up that manuscript image, no marks of punctuation at all. Okay? So when in a modern edition of a text you see marks of punctuation, again, that's part of the interpretation and trying to guide and direct you. Okay, so this is the first five lines. Here's Luisa's translation first. Always the one alone longs for mercy, the maker's mildness. Though troubled in mind, across the ocean ways he has long been forced to stir with his hands the frost-cold sea and walk in exile's paths. Weird is fully fixed. Notice, one word he doesn't translate at all. He keeps the old English, okay? And there are a couple of footnotes. Footnote two, longs for mercy. The old English word yibida here, okay? Translated longs for can also mean awaits or experiences. The word are, mercy, can also mean prosperity in an earthly sense. Riches, in other words. Okay? And then the next footnote for weird. The Old English word for fate, a powerful but not quite personified force. It is related to the verb werðan, meaning roughly to occur. Its meanings range from a neutral event to a prescribed destiny to a personified fate. It's useful to think of weird as what happens. Okay? Usually in a negative sense. In a poem so preoccupied with puzzling over the nature and meaning of weird, it seemed appropriate to leave the word untranslated. Okay. Notice what he says in that last sentence. In a poem so preoccupied with puzzling over the nature and meaning of weird, he has just told you partially his interpretation of the poem. That's what it's about. I don't think it is about that. And you'll see why. Okay. So, oft him on haga are yibideth. Always the one alone longs for mercy. Okay? Oft. Yeah. Can be always. It can also be often. That is, sometimes and sometimes not. Okay? So, often him, okay, on haga means the solitary one or the lonely one. It's literally the one, just the single person. Are, which he translates as mercies, correct? But it can be more than mercies. It can also be graces. It can be gifts. He also says in the footnote, it can be prosperity. Or prosperities, if you want. And then you get this word, yibideth, which as footnote tells you, can mean a variety of things. It can mean awaits. It can mean expects. It can mean
experiences. It can mean endures.
All right? So which one do you choose? Let's put it in a different context. Let's say you're not all waiting for somebody's mercies, grace, favors, gifts. Favors is a word. Okay. Let's replace this with a modern thing, okay, that everybody in here is familiar with. Let's say, let's replace that with a raise. You get more money. Often the solitary one, a raise awaits, expects, experiences, endures. What's the difference between experiencing a raise, actually receiving it, and awaiting it? The one you have, the other one you don't. The one that you don't know that you're going to get one. Okay? State of Tennessee employees got a raise in the governor's recent budget. Not higher education employees. All the other state employees did. The higher education employees did not. Only ones that didn't. Other state employees got a 4% raise. So we, higher education employees, are still awaiting the perspective. Other state employees are experiencing, or maybe even enduring, their raises, let's say. Okay? This is how important translation is. Because notice, what's the difference between awaiting mercies or favors, gifts, graces? This word then gets redefined by this phrase, the maker's mercies. So what's the difference between awaiting the mercies of God and experiencing them? They haven't happened yet, if you're still awaiting them, or if you're expecting them. But when you expect something, how is that different even than awaiting?
Well, awaiting is like you're on the way.
Okay. Expectation implies what?
You know you're going to get it.
It's just a matter of time. But awaiting,
you may not know.
If you've ever read Samuel Beckett's Waiting for Godot, they're waiting how long? Forever, because Godot never shows. Okay? So, often the solitary one, the favors, awaits, experiences, expects, endures, the mercies of God, even though he mod carry. How does the user translate mod carry? Troubled in mind. Mod, mind, spirit, attitude, if you want. Carry, full of cares. Okay? So a mind full of cares. How do you translate that? Troubled? Distressed? Pretty good, you know, expression for 2016 America. A mode carry mind. What? Throughout the lagulada. Okay, yond is throughout. Lagulada, ocean waves. Or just ocean. What? Longa, for a long time, shalada. It's from this word, or the infinitive form of this word, that we get shall. Shall, or must. What? Prarin. That's row, mid hondum, with his hands, not with oars. So he is rowing in the ocean with his hands. So the image is not of somebody in a big boat, but somebody in something modern day, we'd say like a kayak or a canoe. In this period, we're talking the kind of boat would probably be what's called a coracle, a little one-person boat, okay, kind of shaped like a leaf. Right? So he rows with his hands, what? In the prim calda sai. Prim. This is like rhyme. not rhyme R-H-Y-M-E. This is rhyme like hoarfrost. Okay? Rhyme covered. Okay? The ice cold sea. So he's rowing with his hands in the ice cold water. Obviously, what's going to happen to his hands? They're going to get cold. What's going to happen to his feet? They're going to get cold. Why? Because every time he rows, he's probably bringing in a little bit of water. Okay? Laden. Think of any modern English word that looks like wade. Okay? Walk. When you're wading, you're what? You're walking through water. Okay? And then we get this word, Heraclestus, which he translates, I think it's the paths of exile, in exile's paths. Okay? Two words, Heraclestus. I can't do it because my foot. But if you were to look at the bottom of your shoe has a particular shape. The sole is called, it's when it's made, it has a particular last. That's the shape of the footprint. Okay? Different shoes, different kind of last. Dress shoes have a different last than a running shoe or a workout shoe. Okay? So that's kind of the footprint. What about rack? We have this word in modern English. We just don't recognize this spelling and pronunciation of it. It's the source for modern English. Rigid. Rich. Okay. So in the footprints of a wretch. Okay. But it gets translated exile. Why? Well, if you were exiled in Anglo-Saxon England, then you were a wretch. Because you have no people. You have no home. You have no place. See, in Anglo-Saxon England, that image I put up the other day of the hall, this kind of determines your identity. Why? Because you have a place here. You have a connection to the lord of the hall. If you are lordless, another word that means the same thing in Anglo-Saxon, friendless. If you are friendless, if you do not have a benefactor, okay, you don't really have an identity. That's what makes you wretched. So, go back to the beginning. Often, the solitary one experiences, awaits, endures, expects, favors, graces, mercies, gifts, the mercy of God, even though he troubled in mind throughout the ocean, long has to row with his hands the ice-cold sea. This is being replaced by this. Okay. To tread or walk the wretch's path. And then we get this. This is called a gnomic passage. Or you can call it a proverb if you want. Weird bith full red. Weird is fully fixed. Or fate is fully fixed. What does that mean? Fate is fully fixed. How many of you have read Oedipus the King? Only a few of you, okay? You're English majors, even though it's not English. You need to read Oedipus the King because so much modern myth, let's say, derives from it. In Oedipus the King, Oedipus's parents, Jocasta, his mother, and Laius, his father, are told when Jocasta is pregnant, they're given a prophecy. The one in your womb will kill your husband and marry you, sleep with you. They're like, you don't want that to happen. Okay. Oedipus is born. They give him to a slave for the slave to leave exposed on a mountainside. A messenger comes, takes the child, takes him off to another town where he's raised. When Oedipus gets to be a man, a drunk says, you fated to kill your father and sleep with your mother. Oedipus is troubled by this. He goes to the oracle at Delphi. The oracle at Delphi tells him, you are fated to kill your father and sleep with your mother. He doesn't like the idea of that. So he runs away from home. In running away from home, he meets a wagon at a crossroads, and the people in the wagon won't move, so he kills them. Okay? He immediately then arrives at Thebes, the place where he was born, solves the riddle of the Sphinx. What walks on four legs in the morning, two legs in the afternoon, and three legs in the evening? Man. Okay. Solves the riddle of the Sphinx, is hailed as a conqueror, goes into the kingdom or into the city, and is immediately given in marriage the hand of the former queen. She's still the queen, but her husband apparently is dead because he's been away for a while. Okay? And then as the play unfolds, we discover the man that Oedipus killed at the crossroads was none other than Laius, his father, and the woman he's been sleeping with and having children by is none other than Jocasta, his mother. Okay? What's the play show? Weird bith fool red. You can't do an end run around fate. Not even the gods can do an end run around fate. Because in the Greek system, fate lies behind the gods. The gods can see fate. The gods can tell you what is fated to happen. The gods can't change that. They are bound by fate. Okay? So, I wouldn't translate this, or I wouldn't leave this as weird. I would translate it as fate. What is fate really? That which will be. So if you want to, you could say, that which will be is fully fixed. What will happen, period. End of discussion. You try to stop what's going to happen, and you're going to make it happen. Okay? Thus spoke the wanderer, mindful of troubles. We're told, of cruel slaughters and dear kinsmen's downfall. Notice, we get a listing of what he is mindful of. He's mindful of troubles, and then troubles kind of gets modified. It gets amplified with this long, appositive phrase. Cruel slaughters and the downfall of dear kinsmen. Then we have another quote. We have somebody else speaking. We're not sure if the often alone in the first light of dawn, if that's the wanderer speaking, or if it's a second voice. Or I guess it would be a third voice because we have the persona, the narrator of the poem, the wanderer, and now possibly this third voice. Often alone in the first light of dawn, I have sung my lament. Okay, that word often, it's the same word. Oft in Shelda. It's the same word that in the first line gets translated always. So why doesn't he use always again? Variety? Possibly. So, often alone in the first light of dawn, I have sung my lament. What's he mean in the first light of dawn? In the morning? Okay, keep going. Make it personal. Upon waking. What's he think of? My life sucks. That's what he's talking about. I have sung my lament. 21st century American, that is, my life sucks. That's, you know, singing the lament. There is none living to whom I would dare to reveal clearly my heart's thoughts. Okay? This is a quintessential British attitude. Or quintessential, maybe I should say, English attitude. It's that phrase that's personified, or excuse me, that's best exemplified by the stiff upper lip. Grin and bear it. You take what life throws at you and you don't talk about it. Okay? Anglo-Saxon men are not 21st century metrosexual men who are all about, you know, relating their troubles and letting what's inside, no, it's keep everything inside, okay? Why? Because there's none living, he says, to whom he would dare reveal his heart's thoughts. I know it is true. It is a nobleman's lordly nature to what? Closely bind his spirit's coffer. His spirit's coffer. What's a coffer? Not coffin. Coffer. Yeah, it's like a modern language. It'd be a safe. Okay? In Anglo-Saxon, it'd be the hoard. It'd be the lockbox that you treasure things in. Okay? So notice he says it's part of a nobleman's lordly nature to lock that up, to hold fast his treasure hoard. He's not talking about a literal treasure hoard. He's talking about what's in here is your treasure. Okay? Christ says, seek ye first the kingdom of God. Where are you supposed to find that? In here. Not out there. Okay? To hold fast his treasure hoard, whatever he may think. Now, if we were going to read Hamlet, when we did Shakespeare, which I do often, we would hear Polonius give his son, Laertes, a bit of advice. Included in that advice is, give every man your ear, but don't give them your censure. In other words, take what everyone says to you and about you. Somebody demeans you, somebody belittles you, take it, but don't respond. Okay? The weary mind cannot withstand weird. The weary mind, the tired mind, the distressed mind. And the old English word for weary is the old English word for weary. It's weary. Right? What? Can't withstand weird. What does withstand mean? Bear? To fight. Oppose. Okay. Can the unweary mind oppose weird? Nope. Nothing can oppose weird. The troubled heart can offer no help. What's he mean? What's he starting to get at? You can bitch and moan and complain. Yeah, what does it matter? Does that change your reality? Does that change, you know, higher education employees from expecting a raise to experiencing a raise? No, it does not. Okay? And so, those eager for fame often bind fast in their breast coffers a sorrowing soul. What does he mean, those eager for fame? Those who want glory. See, the Anglo-Saxon mindset, even among Christians, okay, is that fame is something to be sought. Glory is something to be sought. Not Kim Kardashian kind of fame, okay? Not always being in the public eye kind of fame. So what does he mean? Renown. To be well thought of by those who follow you. Not follow disciples. Those who come after you. See, if there's one thing everybody wants, it's that when they're gone, people will know they lived. You don't want to die nameless, faceless, forgotten. And that's a kind of a theme that the poet is getting at. So, those who are eager for fame do what? They bind fast in their breast coffers a sorrowing soul. In other words, you lock it up. You don't express your sorrow. Just as I have had to take my own heart, often wretched, cut off from my own homeland. Ah, so what have we just been told? Cut off from my own homeland. He's an exile. Okay? We don't know why. Now, a person can be in exile because they've been banished from their country. That's about the lowest kind of exile you can get. Because it means nobody wants you around. Okay? Maybe you've been made an outlaw. Literally means You are outside the bounds of the law. See, the law is designed to protect. When you become an Anglo-Saxon times, when you become an outlaw, it means the law no longer protects you. You can be murdered. You can be killed. Okay? So, often wretched, come off from my own homeland, far from dear kinsmen, he's done what? He's had to take his own heart and bind it in fetters. That is, he's had to wrap it in chains. He's had to put handcuffs, so to speak, on it. When, ever since long ago, I hid my gold-giving friend in the darkness of earth. What does he mean? Hid my gold-giving friend in the darkness of earth.
Sounds like he's a small
man. Okay. Gold-giving friend. That's Old English. I mean, he's barely even translated that. That is Seven Yarayu Goldwindemin. Since for a long time, my gold friend. Well, who's his gold friend? His gold-giving friend. It's his Lord. Okay? So this tells us a little bit about Anglo-Saxon society. The duty of a lord is to dispense treasure. The duty of a thane to a lord, Old English word, is that. It's modern English, thane, T-H-A-N-E. The duty of a thane is to fight for his lord. Okay? Notice the reciprocity involved here. You fight for your lord, you win treasure for your lord. That is, you go off, you and your band of thanes, you fight a battle, you kill the enemy, you strip the enemy of their treasure, armor, swords and such, rings if they're wearing them. You take all of that back to your lord. Why? It's not yours. It's his. Your lord is usually with you in that battle. Okay? It all becomes his. The lord then has a duty to distribute that treasure among his men. In all Anglo-Saxon literature, and in fact Germanic literature more broadly configured, when the lord doesn't distribute the treasure, it means he's a bad king. And bad things happen to bad kings. Usually their men rise up against them and kill them. Why? Because this is an old, old kind of system of exchange. Right? Each part has a part. Each one has a part to play. If one doesn't play the part, the system breaks down. Okay? So, ever since, long ago, he says, I had to hide my gold-giving friend, his lord. Where? In the darkness of the earth.
He
buried him. He buried his lord. Okay? Assumingly, after the lord was dead. So why is he alive and his lord dead? Could be that he killed him, in which case he probably wouldn't call him his gold-giving friend. If he killed him, then they weren't very friendly at that point. Okay? And yeah, that's probably it. The lord probably died in battle. So why didn't this guy? Here's another component. Another component of Anglo-Saxon culture. This is what's called the fourfold Germanic ethic. This comes from a scholar named C.L. Wren, a study of Old English. You've got four components. One, duty to your lord. Two, duty to your kin. Right? Three, duty to avenge your lord or kin. And four, kind of a reliance or trust, essentially, in weird. Right?
So notice the first part of it. Duty to your Lord. You are bound to your Lord. You are obligated to your Lord. The second part, duty to your kin. Right? Somebody kills your Lord, you are obligated to get vengeance, to seek revenge. Somebody kills a member of your family, you are obligated to avenge that death. Okay? That comes under here. And then reliance, trust, and weird. So, why didn't he die with his Lord? Because in a variety of Anglo-Saxon literature, it becomes pretty clear, if your Lord dies in battle, you should die with him. It doesn't mean you kill yourself so that you die with your Lord. The idea is, if you can still defeat the enemy, then you defeat the enemy. You then don't kill yourself so that you die with your Lord. If your Lord dies first, and you kill the people that killed him, all well and good. You can then go on living. But if the enemy outnumbers you, and it looks like you're all going to die, then you die. You don't take an offer of peace if your Lord is already dead. You don't turn tail and run. Okay? The old English poem, The Battle of Malden, about a half dozen guys turn tail and run. It's their turning tail and run that causes the English to kind of break into confusion. Because when the leader of them, this guy named, it's either Godric or Otta, when the leader of them leaves, the ones who flee, he leaves on the English lord's horse. And so the men think, it's Byrdnoth. He's checking out. Causes a bit of confusion if your captain is leaving, right? He's not, by the way. He's already dead at that point. Okay? So you've got to stick through, and you die with your Lord. In the Battle of Malden, Byrdnoth is one of the first, earliest people to die. He's the captain of the English forces. And his men that survive essentially make a shield wall around his body. And they're going to stand there defending his body. And they die, according to the poem. Every last one of them, except for the five or six that run away. Yeah, you had a question.
Well, yeah, do you hear that when the Lord died, he kind of like got scared and ran away? That it felt like he's in exile? Like he's not really in exile?
I don't think. Some people think that's the case. I don't think so. I think the solution is one of two possibilities. One, he wasn't there for the battle. See, not all warriors would go off to the battle. Some warriors, it would be a small number, would be left behind to protect the hall. Okay? Because the hall is where the Lord keeps his wealth. The hall is where the Lord dispenses justice, all those kinds of things. Okay? That's one possibility. The other possibility is he survives the battle. And he's the only one who survives the battle. We have an example of that, for example, in Beowulf. When Beowulf's lord, Healak, dies, we'll talk about this when we get to the poem, everybody else dies too, except for Beowulf. He's the only survivor of that battle. Probably because he has the strength of 30 men in each hand. Okay? Kind of hard to kill him. So, I think it's actually probably the case that it's one of those two. He's either not there or he's the last surviving member of the war band. Okay? I think it's probably he's not there for some reason. Because when he says, all my relatives are gone, that sounds like he was away from the hall. He was away from the tribe. And the tribe is ambushed. He comes back home. He's been off on some kind of journey. He comes back home to discover a smoldering hall. And he finds his Lord's body, probably hacked to pieces. And he buries it. No one's left. Okay? Which is why he's alone, why he's friendless, why he's relativeless, and why he's no longer in his home. There's nothing there for him.
Okay, so he has to go off. And he tells us, therefore, winter said, over the ice-locked waves, I went, I'm changing the syntax around just a little bit, I went wretched, sought hall sick, that is, sick for a hall, because he no longer has one, hall sick, a treasure giver. He's looking for a new lord. He can't just set up shop as his own lord. Okay? You want a good example of this? Watch on Netflix, The Last Kingdom. It's a BBC series based on a series of novels by a historical novelist named Bernard Cornwell, set in Anglo-Saxon England. And it follows kind of the life of an Anglo-Saxon by the name of Uhtred, U-H-T-R-E-D, okay, who's from Northumbria, the area that Bede was from, all right, whose father is killed and he's captured by Danes, by Vikings. He's raised as a Dane, all right? So he becomes, kind of in identity, a Dane. And then he goes off to fight with, that is for, King Alfred the Great of Wessex, that is, for the English. But what he wants more than anything else is he wants to be his own lord. He has land that it should be his, that his uncle has usurped. Hamlet, if you want, or Lion King, if you want. Just Lion King's just a new version of Hamlet, essentially. Okay, but he can't. He can't just set himself up as king on his own. He has to have money, that is wealth, and land. Okay? Just pick it up on Netflix. So, he says, I sought out Halsik, a treasure giver, a new Goldwine. Wherever I might find, far or near, someone in a meat hall who might know my people. He's telling us he's kind of traveled around. He's asking people, knocks on the door, did you know my people? And he talks about who his people are. Okay? Or who would want to comfort me, friendless. It doesn't mean literal friendless like we think of being without friends. The word for friend here means lordless. This is an example of the translation I don't understand because it's misleading for a modern audience. Okay? Who would accustom me to joy? That is, who would turn his mourning into joy, his sorrowing into joy, who would make it so that when he wakes up in the morning, he doesn't say, first thing out of his life, out of his mouth, my life sucks. But who might say, it's going to be a good day. Right? And then he offers kind of another gnomic passage, another proverb-type passage. He who has come to know how cruel a companion is sorrow for one with few dear friends will understand. In other words, you're only going to understand this if what? If you've experienced it, if it's happened to you. It's the old adage, misery loves company. Okay? The path of exile claims him. That is, the one who has lost his dear friends, his lord, his hall, his people. The path of exile claims him, not patterned gold. And by patterned gold, he means gold woven into beautiful jewelry. Okay? Not patterned gold. A winter-bound spirit, that's what claims him. Okay? Not the wealth of earth. What does he mean? Claims. Okay.
His new identity.
Okay. What else can claim mean? Exactly. Takes, overcomes. So what's he saying? Path of exile takes me. He's bound to it. It's like it owns him, as does a winter-bound spirit. Why winter-bound? Cold, dark, depressing. What's it the opposite of? A summer-bound spirit?
There's no hope.
Okay, exactly. There's no hope. Okay? Rather than patterned gold or the wealth of earth. So what's he saying about patterned gold and the wealth of earth? Okay. Keep going. It's not food. I mean, he's talking material wealth. Okay. Are they the key to his happiness? No. Yeah, we're going to get to that. He is saying the wealth of the earth doesn't do what? Gold doesn't buy happiness. I've got a t-shirt. So, you know, money doesn't buy happiness, but it buys cigars and beer. And that's pretty close. Kind of what he's getting at there. He remembers hall holders and treasure taking. The hall holders are the things, the group of warriors, okay, and treasure taking. How in his youth, his gold-giving Lord accustomed him to the feast. Accustomed him. That is, made it a regular pastime. In his youth, his Lord kind of said, come in, sit close to me. Okay? In his youth. When is he now? If this is the same speaker as the one alone longs for mercy, he's old. We're going to find out later he's white-haired. Okay? That joy has all faded. What joy? The joy of the hall. The joy of earthly companionship. The joy of earthly wealth has all faded for this speaker. And so, he who has long been forced to forego his Lord's beloved words of counsel will understand. That is, if you don't get your Lord's words of counsel because your Lord is gone, you will understand this. When sorrow and sleep both together often bind up the wretched exile, it seems in his mind that he clasps and kisses his Lord of men and on his knee lays hands and head, as he sometimes long ago in earlier days enjoyed the gift throne. What? What does he mean by sorrow and sleep both together bind up the wretched exile? Sleep is no relief. Okay? Keep going with that. He falls asleep in what mental state? Full of sorrow, full of distress. And what happens while he's asleep? He's dreaming of when he did clasp and kiss his Lord of men and laid his hands and head on his Lord's knee. That is an image of supplication. Okay? We see it in the Aeneid. We see it in the Bible. It's apparently, probably, an Indo-European idea. This idea that when you go to seek favor or seek mercy or seek grace from someone, you put your either put your hands around their lower legs and rest your head on their knee, or you put hands and head on the knee, okay? As he sometimes long ago in earlier days enjoyed the gift throne. That is, received gifts from the throne. But when the friendless man awakens again, friendless, lordless, when he wakes up, and what does he see before him? The ocean. Notice, he's not on land. He's on the ocean. And what's he see? Seabirds bathing, spreading their feathers, frost falling in snow, mingled with hail. Then the heart's wounds are that much heavier, longing for his loved one. Now, some interpret that passage to mean he doesn't fall asleep, actually. He is so overburdened with these cares that he sees the birds. And in seeing the birds, he thinks he's seeing his Lord and the things. He's hallucinating. Okay? Sorrow is renewed when the memory of kinsmen flies through the mind. He greets them with great joy, greedily surveys hall companions, and they always swim away. More hallucinations. He's seeing the birds and thinks they're his friends until they swim away. The floating spirits bring too few familiar voices. What's he mean by familiar voices? Human speech. What's he hear? It's not human. Okay? Cares are renewed for one who must send over and over a weary heart across the binding waves. You've got a gloss there. The grammar reference of this intense, almost hallucinatory scene is not entirely clear. The translation reflects one commonly proposed reading. Okay? And so, I cannot imagine for all this world why my spirit should not grow dark when I think through all this life of men. Do you get a change? A little change in attitude? I cannot imagine. The speaker is essentially saying, give me one reason why I should not grow dark. What's he mean by grow dark? Suicidal? Depressed? When I think through all this life of man, how suddenly they gave up the hall floor, mighty young retainers. Gave up doesn't mean they decided to ditch camp one day and leave. Gave up the hall floor is an old English metaphor for they died. When I think through all this life of men, is he talking about solely his hall, his people? No. What's he talking about? Humanity entirely. J.R.R. Tolkien famously said in his essay on Beowulf, all of Old English literature is ultimately about one theme, the death of man and all his works. All of it. Nothing lasts. Okay? So look at what this poet says. Thus, this Middle Earth droops and decays every single day. If you take that to its logical extension, what's he essentially saying? Today, the world is drooping and decaying. Yesterday, it was drooping and decaying. It droops and decays every day. It kind of implies today is worse than yesterday. Tomorrow will be worse than today. If you wake up this morning and said, my life sucks, what's it going to be tomorrow? And so a man cannot become wise before he has weathered his share of winters in this world. Meaning, a man cannot become wise until what? Until he experiences the drooping and decaying. Okay? A wise man must be patient. What's that word patient mean? What's it literally mean, and what is it related to? Okay, long-suffering. Think of a five-year-old, 3 weeks before Christmas, and the tree is decked out, and underneath the tree are a ton of presents. And the kid is told, you have to wait 3 stinking weeks. You're telling the kid, be patient. What are you saying? Suffer. You know, healthy people don't check in at the hospital, right? Sick people check in at the hospital. They're patients. Why? They're suffering. They're enduring. It's related to the word passion, as in the passion of the Christ. Okay? So, a A wise man must be patient, neither too hot-hearted nor too hasty with words. Hot-hearted. What does that mean?
Pride.
Pride? Nor hasty with words. How can you be too hasty with words? Think before you speak. Okay?
Peter.
Yeah. No, Lord, not me ever. It's not going to happen. Jesus says, Peter, shut up. Sit down. Let me wash your feet. Nor too weak in war. Notice, you have to be strong in war. Okay? Nor too unwise in thoughts. Notice all the twos. In other words, it's okay to be unwise in thought. Just don't overdo it. Okay? Neither fretting, nor fawning, nor greedy. All describing
wealth.
Fretting, the rich man who worries about all of his wealth. Fawning, the person who sucks up to the rich man for all of his wealth. And greedy, wanting to become the rich man with all of his wealth. Never eager for boasting before he truly understands. What does he mean? Never eager for boasting before he truly understands. Okay, I'm going to enter politics for a moment. Okay? And let me just lay my cards on the table. I'm far right wing, but I'm more conservative / libertarian than Republican. I'm kind of, done with the Republican Party. So, having laid my cards on the table, what do you think probably is one thing that maybe Donald Trump wishes he'd done a little bit differently? Okay, most of it. Think of the passage again. Okay? Exactly. Never boasting, never eager for boasting before he truly understands. What did he build his campaign on? Think Hadrian's wall. It's going to be a beautiful wall. It's going to be a huge wall, and Mexico's going to pay for it. Okay? And yet, what's he been doing over the last week or two? He's kind of backtracking a little bit in terms of the whole immigration policy. Okay. Just as, I'll be fair politically, just as Hillary, she's not backtracking from her own stuff, she's backtracking from everything her husband did as president. If you look at Hillary's economic plans, all that, it's the exact opposite of what Bill Clinton did. I mean, really the exact opposite. Okay. So, never eager for boasting before he truly understands. Before he truly understands what? What it is he's boasting about. Okay. So a wise man doesn't just go out there and blurt out. I'll use another Republican example. George Bush, September 19th, I think it was, 2001. When he addressed the joint session of Congress, he declared a war, what? On terror. Okay. Why was that, I'll use this language, a hasty boast? Okay, terror's everywhere. What else? What is terror? What is terrorism? It's a tactic. How do you rid the world of terror?
You have to go in all the hidden places.
Only when I kill every other person alive, and I'm the only one left.
Yeah, that's more terror.
I mean, it's the problem with Marxism. How do you make Marxism work when everybody else is dead but you? Because there's always going to be somebody who wants what's yours. And according to Marxism, what's yours is everybody's, actually. So nobody in here is getting an A. I'll just average everybody's out to a C, okay? If I was going to be really Marxist about it. Ask your Marxist professors about that, by the way. So, he must wait before he makes a boast. A man must wait when he makes a boast until the brave spirit understands truly where the thoughts of his heart will turn. In other words, the wise man waits until he really knows what he's going to be able to do. Because he might see Grendel and go, run away, you know. Quote Monty Python. He might realize what he has proposed is an intractable problem. Okay? Politicians do this all the time. All politicians. I don't care if they're the really good ones or the really bad ones. What do? They make promises that they can't keep. I mean, why are rank and file grassroots Republicans so angry at the Republicans in Washington, D.C.? What did they run on in 2010, 2012, 2014? I'm not talking about presidential. I'm talking about congressional elections. They're going to overturn Obamacare. What did they do? Zip, nada, nilch. Okay? Nothing. Okay? So the wise man doesn't make a boast until he knows what way his heart's going to turn. And if you're a modern politician, that means which way this thing turns. Your wallet. The wise man must realize how ghastly it will be when all the wealth of this world stands waste. Okay. The old English word there for waste is idle. Idle. What is something that is idle? Dormant. Not doing anything. Okay. As now, here and there throughout this middle earth, walls stand blasted by wind, beaten by frost, the buildings crumbling. Okay. Notice what he's equating. In the future, how ghastly it will be when all the wealth of this world stands waste. The wealth of this world is not only monetary wealth. It's everything produced by man. As now, here and there. He's not saying everywhere. He's just saying you can see walls doing what? Crumbling. I think the poet probably has in mind Roman ruins. We have an Anglo-Saxon poem titled by modern editors, The Ruin, which we're pretty clear is probably written about the city of Bath. Okay? Beaten by frost, the buildings crumbling, the wine halls topple, the word there for wine hall, for those of you who are Tolkien fans, Medusaid, okay? That's the hall of the Rohirrim, where Theoden reigns. The wine halls topple, their rulers lie deprived of all joys. Nice little euphemism, meaning dead. The proud old troops all fell by the wall. Why did they fall? Because they were defending the hall. The war carried off some, sent them on the way, that is, they died. One, a bird carried off over the high seas. No, we're not talking pterodactyls in Anglo-Saxon. He's talking about one, meaning a part of one. The birds carried off. What birds? Ravens, eagles, vultures come. You know, what's the first part of the body? Birds, at least, go for. Eyeballs. They're nice and soft and juicy, okay? One, a bird carried off over the high seas. One, the gray wolf shared with death. And one, a sad-faced man covered in an earthen grave. I think he's talking about himself. Burying his Lord. The implication, I think, is that this speaker is talking about, I came back and found my hall, and I found the men, the old warriors, these are the battle-scarred, hardened warriors, lined up their remains against the wall, defending the wall, and inside he finds his Lord and buries him. The creator of men thus destroyed this walled city. And that's a pretty accurate description or translation. The speaker does ascribe it to God. Until the old work of giants, the old of giants work, is the passage, does what? Stood empty. Empty is the same word, idle. Without the sounds of their former citizens. Okay. They thought things like the Roman ruins of Bath and Stonehenge were built by giants. Because an Anglo-Saxon looked at Stonehenge and said, how the hell did anybody put that rock on those two rocks? How did they do that? You know. Okay. So, he who deeply considers, what does that mean? He who ponders life, he who thinks about life, he who meditates on life. With wise thoughts, this foundation, meaning the world, the earth, and this dark life, old in spirit, often remembers so many ancient slaughters, and he says these words. And if you're familiar with the Lord of the Rings films, you might be familiar with a little bit of this. Huer quam mari, huer quam mago, huer quam magum yifa, huer quam simbla yisetu, huer sinden saladremas, eala bechbuna, eala birnwia, eala threadnus thrim, hu seofragiwat. Where has the horse gone? Where is the rider? Where is the giver of gold? That's an example of what I was talking about the other day, where there are certain poems where they don't follow the alliterative pattern because you have more than four stressed syllables in that line. Okay? Where's the horse gone? Where's the rider? Where's the giver of gold? In the 1960s, who was it? Peter Paul and Mary, I think it was, had a song, Where Have All the Flowers Gone? Okay? It was an anti-war song. Where are the seats of the feast? Where are the joys of the hall? What's the speaker saying? Where is everybody? Where's all the joy? Oh, the bright cup. Oh, the brave warrior. Oh, the glory of princes. How it's all passed away. There still stands, excuse me, how the time passed away slipped into nightfall as if it had never been. What's the as if it had never been mean? Nameless, faceless, like they never existed. Okay. There still stands in the path of the dear warriors a wall wondrously high. Serpentine stains. A storm of spears took away the warriors, bloodthirsty weapons, weird the mighty. Notice what took away the warriors? A storm of spears, bloodthirsty weapons, weird. And storms batter these stone walls. Frost falling binds up the earth, the howl of winter when blackness comes. Night's shadow looms, sends down from the north harsh hailstones and hatred of men. Remember the passage in Bede? Where Bede is talking about describing the conversion of Edwin of Northumbria. And the one priest says, you know, life of man's kind of like this. We're sitting in this nice hall. It's wintertime. It's warm inside. They're singing, etc. And a sparrow flies in from the outside where it's cold and snowy and hailing. And it comes inside and enjoys the warmth for a little bit and then it goes back out. That's the life of man. What's he describing? Life outside. Okay? But that's life here. All is toilsome in the earthly kingdom. The working of weird changes the world under heaven. The working of weird changes the world. Notice, under heaven. Weird is beneath heaven. Okay? Here, we're told, wealth is fleeting. And he translates fleeting, the old English word, lana, okay, which has two modern derivatives, loan and lean. Here, wealth is a loan. What's the problem with a loan? You have to pay it back. Here, wealth is, he's saying, loaned. Yeah, we think it's ours. Death and taxes, you know, kind of an idea. Here, friends are fleeting. He's not talking about fleeting fair weather friends who turn on you when times get hard. What's he mean? They die. Okay? Here, wealth is fleeting, loaned or lean. Okay? Transitory. Here, friends are fleeting, loaned, lean, transitory. Here, man is fleeting. Here, woman is fleeting. All the framework of this earth will stand empty. Everyone will die. Period. Notice the poem doesn't end there. Some people think it should end there. Some Anglo-Saxon scholars actually think the poem originally ended there. And that some monk comes by later and quote unquote Christianizes the poem. Okay? I think they're crazy, the scholars who argue that. Because I think pretty much if you read the Psalms, that's exactly what this poem is. This poem is like an Anglo-Saxon psalm. It's a rumination on life. The Psalms aren't all about how wonderful life is. David, for the most part, is having a lot of difficulty in the Psalms. So said the wise one in his heart, sitting apart in meditation. Okay? He is good who keeps his word. The Old English word there for word is his troth, his truth, his faith. And the man who never too quickly shows the anger in his breast, unless he, what? Already knows the remedy a noble man can bravely bring about. Okay? The man who never too quickly shows the anger in his breast. You got to go back. The noble man does what? He locks up everything in his heart, and he also doesn't hastily make a boast until he knows which way his heart's going to turn. Unless he already knows the remedy a noble man can bravely bring about. It will be well, what? For one who seeks mercy. It's the same word. If I remember correctly, it will be well. Yes, it is. Well bithamthe him araseketh. It will be well for him who seeks mercy. Consolation from the Father in heaven, where for us all stability stands. The middle of the poem is about not necessarily weird. It's about the instability of life here. You don't know when death is coming. Okay? So how does the poet end it? You want stability? You want real permanence? You want someplace where your friends don't die, where wealth isn't fleeting? Seek it somewhere else. Okay? There where your treasure is, your heart will be also, Christ says. Therefore, don't seek treasure on earth, where moth and rust corrupt. Okay? This poet, seems to me at least, is entirely Christian. Yeah, is there some, to use a modern phrase, existential angst? Yes. There's existential angst in David's Psalms. There's a lot of it. Why? Because life's not easy for anybody. Anybody who really thinks or is aware of life has to acknowledge, yeah, sometimes life sucks. Or maybe most times life sucks. Okay? So the poet says, you want to find where it doesn't? Seek it elsewhere. Okay? Now the poem we're going to do tomorrow is kind of a companion piece to this. It's not as dreary, okay? I also don't think it's as powerful. All right, no, not tomorrow, but whatever the day is, Thursday.